do it.
So it's the end of our roughly two-week trip in Greenland. I'm sitting because I can barely stand. This has without a doubt been the toughest trip expedition I've ever been on. The dives are brutal. they're exceedingly cold. It's crazy in a way.
My name is John Sparks, and I'm a curator of ichthyology at the American Museum of Natural History in New York City.
My name is David Gruber. I'm a marine biologist here at the American Museum of Natural History and a professor of biology at Baruch College, City University of New York.
And we were on an expedition to look at the prevalence of biofluorescence in the Arctic.
Biofluorescence is the process of animals absorbing blue ocean light and transforming that light into other colors.
We had been looking at fluorescence in the tropics, where you get pretty much year-round even amounts of daylight and dark. So we wanted to see if fluorescence was as prevalent or as common in areas where there are very different amounts of daylight. At certain times of the year in polar regions, you get sunlight almost 24 hours a day, and other parts of the year it's dark all the time.
Yeah, it was a little bit like a detective story. We were sitting over a coffee here in New York where it was like, well, I wonder, how does that affect animals underwater when there's just 24-hour light some parts of the year and zero light other parts of the year? And we were surprised, but no one had looked.
We targeted Greenland because there were groups there, like the scorpion fishes, that we found elsewhere that fluoresce, so we could directly compare it to tropical or temperate regions. For this trip, we had to fly to Iceland first, and then we took a small plane to Kulisuk on the east coast of Greenland, and they have just a tiny airport there. And from there, we took about a two-hour boat ride to Sealac, and that was our first diving site.
We did a lot of interesting day dives around there, but when we went another few hours out to this really remote ice camp where we had a cove that we could just dive anytime we want.
As soon as we got to Greenland, we realized, boy, we might be in over our heads. This is really cold. Whose idea was this? And
yeah, it was one thing sitting in a nice cozy little cafe in New York and just kind of pondering these topics, and then once we're in the water in 30 minutes, my hands were just freezing.
But as soon as you get under, you know, you get, your face gets numb, and you've got very limited time to do your work because of the cold, and it burns.
I actually got frostbite in my fingers, but I want to stay longer because it's like we went through so much effort to get out here.
This is our ice camp. We've got our huts here that we sleep in. We've got a makeshift lab we've set up in a storage room.
That's good, really nice.
Yeah, we've got fresh water coming here from the glacier.
And it's delicious. Here we go. These are our dry suits that make diving possible here.
There was so much kelp. Kelp with enormous fronds, and there'd be, you know, little fish swimming or shrimp, lots of shrimp swimming amongst the kelp. It was very, very beautiful underwater.
On land, there's almost nothing living. Like, nothing dares to grow more than a foot off the ground up there, but all the life is really in the ocean. We did dives in several different habitats. We looked in fjords, we looked in the kelp forest, and in several of the dives, we actually looked for specimens in the ice, among the icebergs.
Now, what's really interesting about these icebergs is that they are a refuge for lots of little creatures. Crustaceans live right among the icebergs. There's even fish that kind of dart in among the crevices of the iceberg. So they're like floating habitats for lots of these Arctic creatures.
We would have to position ourselves on the part of the icebergs that didn't have a chance of ice falling on top of us.
We got a warning when we got back to the boat on one dive that we were too close. But you can't, the underwater, you can't tell. He was like, that was kind of dangerous. You were pretty close there. We both didn't know what to expect. I mean, I think in general, we both thought there would be less fluorescence there, just because for a large portion of the year, there's not enough, we thought, ambient light to stimulate a fluorescence in these organisms. So it would be of no use. But then I went up, when we got up there, I thought, we'd find it just as much as anywhere else. But we didn't. Groups that we found all fluorescent members elsewhere, like scorpion fishes, not a single member up there was fluorescent, which really was kind of startling.
In the tropics, almost all hard corals are fluorescent. Many of the anemones are fluorescent. And when we get to Greenland, there's almost zero. And that's interesting.
Lights off.
Oh, look at that, John.
All right, let's take one more with the white light.
That's so cool. There are cases of things that are fluorescent. They're very beautiful, but they're few and far between.
You know, Greenland is really discussed a lot in the news, it being a kind of ground zero of climate change or of change. Really, the fluorescence became one part of the research, but I think the broader thing will be, as the waters begin to warm, are there new fish coming in that didn't used to be there? We don't even really understand fully yet what exactly it is we're losing.
It's such a cold, unexplored environment. We felt like, you know, a lot of these places, we were the first people ever to dive underwater, and that's kind of cool in a way. You know, just look at these habitats that very few people have seen.
What I love about this is that it was really like pure exploration. It was just John and I and a small boat in some of the most far-flung, difficult to get to places. It was, you know, I've been diving for several decades, and it felt like it was just totally new.